for unit number 6. So very important topic, that is your PN sequence generator. So we should know ki how to generate an PN sequence, how we can design an PN sequence generator, and how we can what is the process for designing an PN sequence generator. Because PN sequence generator is a very important part of both your DSSS BPSK and your FHSS also. So in both frequency hopping spread spectrum, we require this PN sequence generator. So we will see how an PN sequence is generated and what are the different building blocks required to generate a PN sequence. And we'll see one example where we'll generate a PN sequence, right? So PN sequence generator, we have to see. Okay, so we'll see a PN sequence generator. So we should know how the PN sequence is generated. So that is our topic of interest for today, that we have to see the different PN sequence generator. Okay. So if you see a PN sequence generator, it has different blocks. And if you see what are the blocks in a PN sequence generator, or what are the different parts of a PN sequence generator, if you want to generate a PN sequence, we require certain components, electronic components in it. PN sequence generator is generally made of shift register. It is generally made of shift registers. And if you see the shift registers, they are made of what? They are made up of flip-flops. So what electronic components will require? Will require some flip-flops that will act as a shift register. Then we'll require some modulo 2 adder. Modulo 2 adders will be required to perform the XOR addition of two inputs. So modulo 2 adders are required. Adders. Okay. So these are the two different electronic component, important electronic component that are required to design a PN sequence generator. Okay. So how this use of flip-flops and modulo 2 adders are used to design a PN sequence, we'll see with one example. So the example is like this: design a PN sequence of length, or we can say the length of, or we can say talk about, when we talk about a PN sequence, we generally talk about its maximum length. Okay, so the question will come like, design a PN sequence generator to generate a PN sequence of maximum length 7. Okay, so we have to generate a PN sequence that will be having a maximum length of 7. Maximum length of 7, or length means what? The number of bits in a PN sequence. So what we understand from this given data, we have to generate a PN sequence for a maximum length of 7. Means somebody will give you key, just get a PN sequence with a maximum length that will having a maximum length of 7 bits. Okay. So I will require a PN sequence having a maximum length equal to 7. So that is my design problem. Design a PN sequence with maximum length of 7. So we call this length, maximum length of a PN sequence as an input to the designer. Now, designer has now to choose for this 7 bits, 7 length means 7 bits, we can call it as. How many bits should be there at the output of PN sequence? 7 bits. So 7 bits PN sequence we need to design. Now the designer has to choose what should be the, how many flip-flops will be required. How many flip-flops will be required, and how many modulo 2 adders will be required to generate a 7 bit, or the maximum length sequence of 7 bits. Okay. So as we have this input to us, we have to design a maximum length sequence 7. That is, we have the maximum length value. From that, we have to get the flip-flop value. Now, for that, we should know what is the relation between maximum length of PN sequence and number of flip-flops required. So the number of flip-flops required, suppose the unknown is M, we should know what is the relation of this M with this length of PN sequence. So the relation is the maximum length sequence or the maximum length of a PN sequence is equal to 2 raised to, we can call it as 2 raised to M. This is a rest term, so I will put in here a rest to. So I don't think we have an option here in this here to put in square term or the rest to term, but we'll use this rest to M. 2 raised to M, M is the number of flip-flops used to generate that PN sequence minus 1. So 2 raised to minus 1. So now what we have the maximum length designer or the what you want to design the input to is that the maximum length is 7. You have to design a PN sequence with maximum length equal to 7. So how many what will require is the number of flip-flops. So from this we can say how many flip-flops will be required. So 2 raised to 7. So what will be the value of M? So number of flip-flops, that is the required to design the PN sequence. M is the number of flip-flops. So what do you think from this formula? We will get the number of flip-flops. How many flip-flops will be required? Yes. How many flip-flops will be required? So your 7 equal to 2 raised to M minus 1. So M value is 2 raised to 3 minus 1. So M value, how many flip-flops will be required? Will require here 3 flip-flops. So here we have got your first answer as an PN sequence generator will require 3 flip-flops to design a maximum length sequence of 7 bits. Okay. So that is the first thing what we want to do. Then how many modulo 2 adders will be required? Now it is up to you how many modulator 2 adders you will require, but generally the recommendation is for an 3 flip-flops, if you have 3 flip-flops, then the ratio for maximum number of modulo 2 adders n is given as 1. So we can use 1 maximum 2 adders with the 3 flip-flops. Now with this we have this value of these two electronic components that will be useful for us to design a PN sequence or to implement a PN sequence generator. Now these two values we have got M value, that is the number of flip-flops, equal to 3, and modulo 2 address N equal to 1. Now this is okay. Now when we say modulo 2 adders, it will be required an input from the 2 flip-flops at least, because it will take 2 input from 2 flip-flops and give it as an output. Its output can be connected to one of the flip-flops. Now which flip-flops the input should be connected, which flip-flops the output which flip-flops output should be connected to modulo 2 adders, its table is also given. So the tap gains for if you have an 3 flip-flops, then the tap gains should be taken at the output of flip-flop 3 and flip-flop 1. Now it is table given, you can refer your book for this. So the tap gains you can take at when we use 3 flip-flops at the output of first and the third flip-flop, and then it should be given to the input of again to the first flip-flop. Now if you see the arrangement of PN sequence and the generator, then it is very simple. Now for these 3 flip-flops will require suppose 3 flip-flops will take, suppose this is the first flip-flop, this is the second flip-flop, and this is the third flip-flop. Okay, so they are arranged in term of shift register. So they are arranged at one after another as a suppose we will take that as F1, F2, and F3. So for the first flip-flop, we'll say it is F1. For the second, we'll say it is F2, and the third we'll say it is F3, and the for the third flip-flop we can say it is F3. So three flip-flops are connected arranged in series with each other, and the output of suppose this is a D flip-flop or any flip-flop you can take, but we consider here D flip-flop, then the output of flip-flop 1 is given to the input of flip-flop 2, and the output of flip-flop 2 is given as an input of flip-flop 3. Okay, then we have this modulo 2 adder. Suppose we have this modulo 2 adder somewhere connected here. So this is your modulo 2 adder. Okay, so this is your modulo 2 adder, suppose. And just draw it properly. Modulo 2 addition, let's say. Okay, or just modulo 2 adder. Okay. So this is your modulo 2 adder. So one modulo 2 adder we have decided, and three flip flops, they are connected in series. Now we have said that the output of the third and first flip flop should be given to the input of modulo 2 adder. So modulo 2 adder input, the first input will be the output of third flip flop, that is the last flip flop. Okay, just see the arrangement or the design of the PN sequence. Okay, so that will be the first input. Okay, second input will be the output of the flip-flop 1. Okay, so these are the two inputs to the modulo 2 adder, and the output of modulo 2 adder is connected as an, as it is a shift register, obviously it will be connected to the input of flip-flop 1. It will be connected to input of flip-flop 1. Just see, note down the arrangement. So it is fed back to the flip-flop 1. So this is the arrangement. I'll just show here. So this is an input, we can say the arrows will decide what is the output and input, right? Okay, and where we get the PN sequence, we get the PN sequence at the output of flip-flop 3. So here what we get is your PN sequence. Okay, so this is an arrangement to design a PN sequence of maximum length 7, where we have used three flip-flops, F1, F2 and F3, one modulo 2 adder, whose tap gains or whose inputs are at the output of flip-flop 3 and flip-flop 1, and the output of modulo 2 adder is feedback to flip-flop 1. Okay, so initially, now we'll have this arrangement. Initially, I want to draw a table actually. Can we draw it? Don't think. Okay, forget it. Just draw by our free hand drawing. Okay, so how many flip-flops are there? Suppose we'll write it here. Number of flip-flops is F1, F2, and F3. Okay, so initially, when there is no clock pulse to these flip-flops, so we have the clock pulses also given to these flip-flops. Okay, so common clock are given to all these flip-flops. Okay, so this is the clock input. So what we understand is, when initially there is no clock pulses, the input or the condition or the flip-flops all will contain and bits that are all zero. This is called as a reset condition. Okay, so that is the initial condition of any flip-flop where there is no input pulse, where all the content of the flip-flop is equal to zero. Now, if you see before the next pulse come, if you see the what is the input to your F1 and F3? So what is the input to your F1 and F3? The input to F1 and F3 is modulo 2 input. Okay, and how this modulo 2 adder works? So if you take this modulo 2 addition, if you look back and just remember your modulo 2 addition, when both the inputs are same for the modulo 2 adder, its output is always, yes, its output is always. So if you take here zero, so what were the two inputs to the modulo 2 adder? Zero, modulo 2 addition with zero. What will be the output? So both inputs are same. So the truth table says the output will be equal to 1. So I will take here, I will give some notation here. Suppose this is the output of your modulo 2 adder. Suppose S. S is the output of modulo 2 adder. So at when both its inputs are 0, F2 and F3, the modulo 2 adder will be equal to 1. What will be the modulo 2 adder? The output will be equal to 1, as the output of flip-flop 1 and flip-flop 3 both are 0. Okay. Now, this modulo 2 adder, this is the initial condition. This is the initial condition of the flip-flop. Now, when the first clock pulse will be received, it will put or shift this input. This is connected to what? This S value is connected to what? Flip-flop 1. So we can say the initial condition, this is what is an initial condition for your modulo 2 adder. So what is the content of the flip-flop for the initial condition? For the two inputs F2 and F3 0, your S output will be 1, and that will be the content of flip-flop 1. So this is the initial condition of the flip-flops 1 0 0, or this will be the initial state of your shift register. Okay, based on the modulo 2 addition, based on the modulo 2 addition. Okay, so when the next clock pulse will come, this one will be shifted, at this point, this one will be shifted at this point, and this zero will be shifted to the next flip-flop. This zero will be shifted to the next flip-flop. That is an arrangement of your shift register. Now, for this 1-0 arrangement or the shifting of this flip-flop, what will be your S output of your modulo 2 adder? So the modulo 2 adder, what will be the content of the modulo 2 adder that we have to see? Now the content for S2 and S3 are both are 1 and 0. And we have taken the input from what? Modulo 2 adder input is taken from, sorry, we have just mistakenly written here, because I was just, you have to point out to me, we have taken, this is the initial condition, right? But what is the input to your modulo 2 adder? The input is F1 and F0. It is not F2 and F3. The input is F1 and F0. So we have to consider this F2 and F3. So when the input is F2 and F3, here obviously it will be again 1. When the next clock pulse will come, it will be 1. So this will be shifted, F1 content will be shifted to F2, and F2 contents will be shifted to F3. So this will be the condition for the initial condition, or the based on the initial condition, this will be the state of your flip-flops. Okay. Now again, we'll consider this 1-0. So if this is 1-0, what will be your S? S value will be equal to 0. For 0-0, it is 1. For 1-0, it is 0. Now, what will be the next condition that we have to ascertain? And likewise, we have to go on shifting your inputs from one shift register to other, and we have to generate a PN sequence. So you do this, if you shift this, so initial state is taken as, so if you shift this, this will be what? This is F1, right? And this is your F2. So one XOR 0. So what will be the output? Output will be, yes, what will be the output? Yes, I don't have a solution here because I have not done this. But if you go for the modulo 2 addition, what will be the output of this? Yes. Based on the modulo 2 addition. Okay, you work out this, and at the output we will get a PN sequence that will be having a maximum length of 7. Okay, so this is how we can design a PN sequence generator, and based on this PN sequence generator we have to see some properties of PN sequence generator. So the first property of PN sequence generator, it is its what we call it as an run property. So what do you mean by runs and all that? That we'll see in the next lecture when we discuss the different properties of a PN sequence. For now, you have to just understand how we design a PN sequence generator. So for to designing a PN sequence generator, we'll require 3 flip-flops, 1 modulo 2 adder for our maximum length sequence 7. If you change this maximum length to any other value, suppose 15, 20, your number of flip-flops will change, and also the number of modulo 2 adders required to design a PN sequence generator. Okay, so that the properties of PN sequence generator and how it affects the its application in DSSS and FHSS squared spectrum technique, that we'll see in the next lecture. Today the attendance is very less. So what is the reason? Anybody having any reason why the attendance is less for today? Is there any holiday? Yes. Kay sutti bitti hoti ka madhe? Aaj sakali lecture zala na tumcha DSP cha? DSP cha lecture zala na? किती स्ट्रेंथ होती त्याला, म्हणजे किती मुलं होती त्याला? एवढेच होते का? बरं,
40 स्टुडंट होते सर.
हा, किती होते?
40.
मग आता तर 30च आहेत. नाव ओनली 30 आर देअर. सो वेअर आर द अदर्स? कुठे गेले? नाश्ता करायला गेले काय ते? They have gone for getting their breakfast. Okay, okay. So we'll just take the attendance now.